Arts Magazine. My name is Ed Morin. With me is Judy Sobol, who's director of the Joan Whitney Payson Gallery of Art at Westbrook College in Portland.
Maine Arts Magazine is a brand new program for MPBN-TV. On the third Wednesday of each month through June, we'll have a half hour of news, features, and calendar information to let you know what's happening in the arts in the state of Maine.
Judy and I are at the Portland Performing Arts Center. This seemed like an appropriate place to kick off a magazine program like this one. Right here in this building is the home of the Portland Stage Company. In fact, Judy and I are sitting on the set of Miss Alliance by George Bernard Shaw. This building also contains the headquarters for the Ram Island Dance Company, the Casco Bay Movers Dance Company. Downstairs is a commercial art gallery. There's also a music store and a couple of good restaurants.
We're only a few blocks from Portland City Hall, where the Portland Symphony Orchestra performs, and only about a block from the church, where the Portland String Quartet and the New England Piano Quartet perform.
In short, we're kind of in the middle of it here. And that's where we hope Maine Arts Magazine stays, right in the middle of what's happening in the arts.
Not only in Portland, but through the entire state of Maine. Actually, for our first feature on Maine Arts Magazine, we don't have to travel very far, just a few blocks up the hill. However, our report is about an exhibition with statewide significance.
On Friday, the Portland Museum of Art opened the fourth Maine Biennial. More than 400 artists submitted over 1,000 paintings for jurying. Less than 100 paintings were selected for inclusion in the Biennial.
Oh, it's colorful and bright and full of good paintings. There's a lot of painting going on in this room, in these rooms in the museum right now. There's some stronger painting than I even knew was going on here, to be perfectly honest, despite the fact that we were in a gallery. And there's a lot more painting, a lot more going on than I had really realized, and they put together a hell of a show.
Rob Elowich and his wife Annette own Portland's Beredoff Galleries.
Okay.
84 paintings, works of 64 artists associated with the state of Maine, are included in the 1985 Maine Painting Biennial. The first of these biennials took place only 6 years ago, but that first exhibition set the pattern. These are open, competitive shows. The Portland Museum of Art decided to restrict entries this year to paintings and chose to have three New York art professionals jury the show. As we've heard, Rob Elowich has nice things to say about the biennial at the Portland Museum of Art. John Halverson is director of the museum.
I think the result of the exhibition is that we have it's very much a mixed bag. It really, I think, could be sealed in the time capsule and could be a valid exhibition showing everything that was going on in Maine during 1983, 1984. It's not a unified show by any means at all. There are pockets of very mixed, very contrasting styles.
From soup to nuts. That's what Halverson says was submitted for jurying, and that's what's on display in this exhibition.
I think what the jury was looking for, as they said at the press conference, was not so much a style as clarity, strength, and the directness of the vision of what was behind however it happened to come out. The results are, as I've said, there are some familiar names. Some of them are really very beautiful works by familiar names. Some interesting, powerful works by people I've never heard of. And a lot of other material that is, part of the context, I think.
A few years ago when they had a juried biennial, they ended up with being a little patronizing, I think, toward Maine. They chose things on velvet with deer jumping through the forest and so forth. This time, I really didn't know what to expect. No announcements were made about who was going to be in the show, and there were so many people here that I didn't even know painted. I think one of the surprises is that there are a lot of closet painters in this state, some of whom were doing some pretty exciting things. Yeah. That was the biggest surprise. Walking through the front door over here and coming in on all this color and all this painterliness and all this excitement was really a nice thing.
Do you think that there are any tendencies? Do you think that there are any particular styles that you can say, and not just one that would cover the whole thing, but maybe different ones that are represented here strongly?
You know, we get into the problem of labels, of course, again, and I think everybody on opening night was talking about, gee, there's neo-expressionism in Maine, and I don't know if I know even what that means. I don't know if anybody really knows what that means. It fits to the extent that there's a lot of very personal work, there's a lot of very strong work. You know, even when there are some more obvious landscape kind of things, that they're not really the typical landscapes of even the people who I think of. There are an awful lot of the more standard-looking kind of paintings that aren't as standard-looking as if you look at them as one might think of them in a different setting than they are here. I do think that there was a New York approach here. I do think that there was some looking for what's going on in a provincial sense, in a way, in New York City. Is it happening in Maine? And I think the show sort of proves that it is. And in a way, that's good because it means that we're right there. In a way, it has a less regional feeling in many ways than it might have had otherwise.
So you say, if you were to walk through the doors and look in here, you really wouldn't have the idea that this is the Maine painting by
I think that's exactly right. I don't think you would have that idea. You'd have to look in some of the corners where I think the people who hung the show, as opposed to the people who found you put the show together, may have hidden some things so that the show did begin to come together in certain ways. But there are very few of those, and those are well hidden, actually. You know.
Yeah, there are a few.
And I don't mean that they're bad. I'm just saying that they're not quite in the keeping of the mood that I get when I first come through the door, certainly. But they've done a nice, this beautifully hung, and it's a terrific show.
During a press conference several weeks ago, the three jurors for the 1985 Biennial said they weren't familiar with one of the 422 painters who submitted works for judging. If this means the most famous of Maine's artists didn't edit works, it also means jurying was free of political influences. A competitive show, however, is also going to lack the works of artists who don't like the competitive process. You can't please everybody. In fact, controversy seems to be inevitably associated with large exhibitions like this. Large, expensive exhibitions like this. The Biennial will cost the Portland Museum of Art around $20,000 out of pocket, and more than $40,000 overall. Staff time for accepting works, for publicity, for hanging the show, cost the museum money, even if it's not extra money. And $10,000 from the Maine State Commission on the Arts and Humanities, and funding from Casco Northern Bank won't cover the out-of-pocket. To try and recover some of their costs, the museum decided to charge a $10 entry fee for the 1985 Biennial, money to be used to pay for out-of-state jurors and the like. A number of Maine artists were unhappy with this entry fee, and a few chose not to enter works rather than pay the money. To show the work of contemporary Maine artists and craftspeople, the Maine Arts Commission has made dollars available for biennials. Having had four such exhibitions to evaluate, the commission has decided to make more money available for exhibitions each year, $15,000 instead of $5,000, but it's also decided that the new Contemporary Visual Arts Exhibition Program should have tighter guidelines. Denny Wilson is Executive Director of the Maine State Commission on the Arts and Humanities.
Solely, what we're doing is saying these are a few things that we would like to see included, resident artists, juror from out of state, so forth and so on. We've also said that we'd like to see promotion being a very, very key part of this, that posters and catalogs and purchase prizes whenever possible to help promote and sell the work of artists. These are suggestions we've made as well as some guidelines that we've insisted upon. Again, the resident artist situation.
Denny Wilson says he expects the Contemporary Visual Arts Exhibition Program will foster a number of smaller exhibitions, some of single disciplines in the arts and crafts, others multidisciplinary. He also believes larger exhibitions, like the current painting biennial, will be made possible with the help of commission funding.
The Maine Painting Biennial is at the Portland Museum of Art through March 3rd.
Now we're going to travel to Gorham on this first Maine Arts Magazine program on MPBN-TV. The University of Southern Maine's theater ensemble, the Russell Square Players, has a lot of outstanding productions to its credit.
And tomorrow, the 19 cast members are going to be matching their skills against casts from five other colleges in the region.
The Russell Square Players presented the play Volpone in December at USM. The production was one of 45 plays from the New England region juried as part of the American College Theater Festival, and one of six plays selected to go to Durham tomorrow for the festival's New England regional program at UNH. A couple of weeks ago, we went to Gorham to watch a rehearsal and talk with some of the people involved. Minor Roots is professor of theater at USM and director of Volpone.
Volpone, written by Ben Jonson originally, a contemporary of Shakespeare's, deals with greed. And the synopsis of the story basically is a man who feigns being sick in order to have people bring gifts to him, hopefully that they will become heirs to his fortune.
Oh, Mosca, you've been my parasite for 8 weeks. Have you seen one single golden beetle creep out of my treasure chest in that time?
Never. Indeed, a whole new swarm has settled there.
And how do I do it? The gold pulls them here. I do nothing but say I am rich. Already they bow their backs in reverence. Then I let them know I have no wife, no child. Their very tongues hang out. And then I make a pretense of mortal illness. Then the water drips on the floor and they begin to dance for my money.
They do bring gifts. And there are complications with these gifts. The gifts constitute everything from golden goblets to wives. So it has quite a spectrum of the type of gift that is brought.
Now, you said originally
yes.
The play has changed?
It has been changed because the version that we're using is Stefan Zweig, who was a German, wrote it in 1923, and it's an adaptation, really, of the original Volpone. He was trying to make another point at that time, the fact that all the people who are guilty do not always get paid just desserts, as they did in Ben Jonson's play. Everyone, both the greedy and the, whether they were looking for money or Volpone, all received some kind of just punishment. Not so in this play. Now, that's about all I'll tell you as far as the end of the play.
No wife or child, utterly low. Why, he thinks of no one but his friends.
Ah, yes, oops, his friends.
Daddy, did you bring the will with you so I can have him fill it out?
I never forget. Come. Here it is, all filled out, nothing missing but his signature.
He'll give us that, never fear.
We don't like to use the word competition. In other words, this is supposed to be a festival, but...
are there winners?
Well, if you are chosen, you will. If you are chosen from the regional, you will be performing at Kennedy Center in Washington. So I guess you might say there are. Yes, it's a mini Super Bowl for us, you might say, for college theater.
How did you happen to be chosen to even go to the regionals?
The schools that are interested, or the plays that are the schools that are interested in entering their plays, submit the plays to the region. They are judged by a group of, I consider, very competent judges that go around to the various campuses, see the shows, and then from there they will choose 6 plays to go to the regional festival, which is in Durham this time. Then in Durham, there are national judges, and national judges will have seen the other 11 regions, I believe. Yeah, 11, there's 12 in all. And from that, they will choose 8 plays that will go on to the Kennedy Center.
In the play, Volpone has helped duping people. Mosca, the lackey, is the fast talker who manipulates his master's unsuspecting prey. Mosca is played by USM senior theater major Craig Foley from Westbrook.
Do you think it's harder to go out and perform knowing that there are jurors down there who are taking notes on you rather than doing something because you are an entertainer? People have come to be entertained for an evening. Does it make any difference to you at all?
This is the second year that we've been selected twice in a row now. Last year with All My Sons, which I was in this show. And last year it made a difference to me, but not this year. And maybe it's just because I'm used to it. I don't know any other reasons than that, but it didn't seem to this year. I forgot totally that they were out there. And in this play, too, I'm on stage all the time, too, so I may have not had time to think about it. That may have been the difference, too. But it's funny that you said that, because that was after everything clicked in, I said, I couldn't even remember them being out there now.
Isn't this awfully hard? I mean, what, a month or so ago, you were at performance level with this play. Now you have to go compete. You have to get it together again.
Mm-hmm.
What's the process of trying to get back to performance level on a play?
Well, for me, the role was really a challenge to me in a lot of ways. And I don't think I met that challenge the first time around fully. And this is going to give me a chance to meet it more fully this time, which I'm excited about. So that process is hopefully a growing one for everyone involved. Trying to complete your sense of what the character is and what the play is about with a little bit of objectivity behind you. That 4 weeks that we've had as an in-between time is gives us all a sense of objectivity after we've heard of other people's thoughts about the play, after various performances have sunk into our minds and what was happening. From there, I think we all can grow with that.
And if you play it from here across,
all right,
and you have come over, in other words, I don't know when you can get over in order to get the, to make this, he's recognizable.
No,
Tori has left.
Yeah.
I like what you're doing. So if we get, in other words, the threesome, the head's right here, so you're watching between the two of them, back and forth, a little bit. Let's see what happens. It's an old trick, an old gag. Let's see what happens.
Okay.
Volpone isn't an easy play to produce. Director Minor Root says he's wanted to do Volpone for a long time. The reason he attempted the play this year is because he feels he finally has a group of actors who can handle such a show.
Wait. I saw Master Notary on the stairs. The Notary, yes. He's a curious beast. He never gave thought for Master Volpone before, but of a sudden he is so concerned. Well, he came of his own accord to draw the will.
We want to wish the Russell Square players from USM the best of luck as they compete at the University of New Hampshire in Durham tomorrow.
For our final story this month on Maine Arts Magazine, we're going to talk about violin making. Well, really about the violin maker. Portland is home for this craftsman, but Jon Cooper had to travel a long way from home to learn the skills that are now building his reputation. Jon Cooper worked for about 12 years as a professional musician, performing around Kennebunkport with local bands. In 1976, he joined Wild Mountain Time. Cooper finished his career as a performer with the well-known Maine group, the Ambassadors.
A musician's life is a limited one. You can only go with it for so many years. It becomes much more difficult after a while. You get to a certain point where you're sort of just going to go around and repeat everything you've already done once before, or three times, or four times. And it's interesting for a while, but past a certain point, the lifestyle of it is not very interesting anymore.
While touring Italy with the Ambassadors, Jon Cooper found the violin shop he was eventually to work in, learning his new and present trade. Cooper apprenticed in Italy for 2 years. If you walk into Jon Cooper's shop for a custom-made violin, you'll sit down and talk about what you want your instrument to do.
Let's say I want to build an instrument like a viola. It has a nice round sound to it. Isn't a very penetrating sound, but more of a broad, open sound, what they would call a dark-sounding instrument. I won't use a very hard piece of wood for the top and back. That would be more suited to a violin that I really wanted to speak and to be clear and crystalline sounding. I would use a softer wood. In the way in which I form the arching, I would perhaps make it a little bit broader and flatter in the center. I would perhaps make it a little bit lower, all things that would make it flexible. So I have to take into account the materials, which aren't so easy to measure. There's no way that you can just take a piece of wood and know this is how it's going to be, and it's going to be this way throughout. You don't know until you start working. You can only judge. And that is what comes from experience and something that you really spend your whole life learning.
A number of variables can be built into a violin. And when you go to Cooper for an instrument, you're making a decision to work with a craftsman who constructs his products according to a specific school of instrument making.
I work in the what is called the Italian system of making instruments, which is the older system where you use a form that's internal inside the instrument rather than outside. I take the internal form and I'll put the blocks on, the corner blocks and the end blocks. Now from these blocks, I'll then shape the ribs, which will adhere directly to the mold. They won't be glued onto the mold. The only place they'll be glued on will be the blocks, which enables me later to separate the ribs from the mold. So once I've bent the ribs and fashioned the corners, I've now determined the outline of my instrument. The shape is originally carved out with a gouge and then brought a little bit closer to being the final shape with a small plane. I use small violin makers' planes. From that point, once I get close enough, I'll use a scraper to take the final curves into the arching. Usually just an old piece of, I use bandsaw blades or old thin pieces of metal with the right consistency to form a nice little hooked edge on it to scrape the final surface.
The top and back of the violin are built quite differently. The top has a uniform thickness.
The maple back is left slightly thicker in the middle, tapering down to a thinner towards the edges. So as I start to work on the back, I'll make a drawing on the back and draw in the numbers and start working down towards a certain number. Past a certain point, I'll stop looking at the numbers and determine the final thicknesses by flexing the top in different directions and by tapping on it.
This is the final step before the body of the instrument is glued together. The violin is almost done now. What remains is an application of varnish.
Sometimes we'll string them up in the white and listen to them without the varnish on. The difference is remarkable. A violin without any varnish sounds totally different than a violin with varnish. So from this we determine that a violin varnish has quite a bit of bearing on the sound. It's like a skin that you place over the whole instrument, and it's going to shrink slightly once it's put on. It's going to make the instrument sound closed, but it's also going to make this instrument sound more defined. If you play an instrument without a varnish, they sound sort of wild and open, and the sound doesn't sound very defined. By varnishing, you then make the sound more focused. It's almost like a final focusing that's put on the instrument. People work in a different way than they work today. We tend to want to imitate perfection, things we see in molded things and things that have been made so perfect, cut by machine, perfect lines, perfect edges. The older makers worked in a different way, and so we still work in this way. We don't feel so bound to making everything perfectly smooth and round, and so that it still shows it was done by hand, basically.
Music has changed a lot during the last 250 years. Performance spaces and audiences are larger. Instruments have to be louder. Music today is played at a higher pitch than in Stradivari's day, and that's hard on an instrument. Modern concert instruments take a lot more abuse traveling around than they did. If violins and their music have changed so much, why Cooper strict adherence to 200-year-old techniques? Can't computers be used to mass-produce Stradivari's?
They do take Stradivari instruments. They will take an exact Stradivari instrument, make a model of it perfect to the line. They do this in Japan with lasers to make copies of instruments. They'll copy an instrument perfectly in three dimensions, and then with a laser cutter, they'll cut it out so it's identical right down to the little scratches on the top. They'll take the instrument. They'll take 500 pieces of wood, run them through the machine, 500 instruments that are photographic copies of the Stradivari. Every one of them sounds terrible, because you're just stamping them out with a cookie cutter. There's no personality in it, nothing done to consider the wood, the materials.
Judging by the caliber of his clientele, one guesses the young man is a respected and trusted addition to Maine's musical scene. Stephen Kexkamethi of the Portland String Quartet is one of the best-known violinists in Maine. He dropped in while we were taping to have a few repairs made on his instrument and bow.
Would you change this room?
Yeah. The strings? I can change the strings, too.
But you change what? Change.
But I can change these protectors that are under here. See, this one's got a pretty big
yeah, exactly.
hole in the bridge. How's the string height? String height looks low. I mean, it could be higher. It just depends on what you're used to. That requires making another bridge, and it's up to you as to whether you want to do
well, what's... What do you charge on a bridge?
About $25. The only thing that speaks against it...
Is?
The fact that the top is weak, but another millimeter isn't going to kill it either way.
Cooper spends more than half his time repairing instruments. Sometimes the repairs are necessary because another person did a bad job trying to make repairs. He also says many musicians don't know as much as they should about instrument care. Jon Cooper has taken on a life's work that will keep him as busy as he wants to be. The stock of great instruments, many 200 to 300 years old, is becoming depleted. Wooden pieces eventually wear out. Musicians want new instruments to use as substitutes for their expensive old instruments. Who wants to take a $100,000 violin outside for a concert? A good copy will do just fine. New instruments also are a good choice for young musicians. There's another reason performers become interested in new instruments. Maybe, just maybe, Jon Cooper or one of his contemporaries is the violin maker who will produce the great instruments of the future. Stradivari didn't make his great violins till near the end of his 93-year life. The more wood he handles, the more instruments he makes, the more Portland's young violin maker will come to know what goes into producing the sounds that have made the violin such a favorite instrument.
To 75 years ago, there were a lot of violin makers in the state of Maine. Jon Cooper is working with the Stanley Museum in Kingfield, putting together an exhibit about Maine violin makers. If any of you viewers have any information about violin makers from Maine, Jon Cooper would love to have you contact him.
Thank you, Judy. Well, that about wraps up our first Maine Arts Magazine program on MPBN-TV. As we hope you know, the Maine Public Broadcasting Network tries to be responsive to what our viewers want. If Maine Arts Magazine is the kind of program you want to see on MPBN-TV, let us know. If you have any suggestions for topics or about anything else, drop us a line about that too. I'm Ed Moore.
And I'm Judy Sobol. Join us again next month for Maine Arts Magazine.